Hi, I'm Skolovac, and in a few moments, I'm going to talk about these right here, guardrails, and how they can help you maintain governance and yet agility in a self-service environment such as cloud. That's coming up next. All right, let's get right into it. Today we're going to talk about the Government of Canada Cloud Guardrails. So we're going to start off with talking about where the cloud guardrails came from. We're going to talk about why we talk about guardrails. It's perhaps a strange term for some people, but we've chosen our guardrail style of governance and why it's different from other methods of governance. We're going to talk about what the guardrails actually are. So what are the guardrails that need to be respected? We're going to talk about the operationalization framework, which is the process around the guardrails. We're going to talk about what happens when a department is non-compliant with the guardrails and the escalation process. We're going to talk a little bit about some of the tools the community has created. Been some great contributions there. And finally, we'll talk a little bit about the future of the guardrails. So, how did the guardrails really come about? So Shared Services Canada had done some fantastic work during the summer of 2019, late summer 2019, and they had qualified the first two cloud providers on the framework agreement. Now, what's interesting about this framework agreement, and it's a contractual framework agreement, is previously the Government of Canada had only created enterprise-wide contracts for unclassified cloud services. So these are cloud services that had been qualified against Government of Canada requirements to host unclassified data. The framework agreement had requirements for protected B data. So, you know, again, Shared Services Canada had done some fantastic work on both contracting agreements, and this was the next step. So we want to make sure that certain minimal protections were in place for each department that was using the framework agreement. And at the same time, we also want to keep the benefits of an enterprise approach. So September 2019, the Government of Canada Enterprise Architecture Review Board approved a certain number of minimal protections that every account had to have. And those were known as the Government of Canada guardrails, and the process around that is known as the operationalization framework. So before we dive into the guardrails, let's talk about why we talk about guardrails. So traditionally, we tend to govern with gates. And in a gating style of governance, what you're really doing is bringing forward evidence, a package of evidence in which you're saying, here I'm demonstrating compliance, right? And a gatekeeper would then determine, a gatekeeper would determine if you've met the criteria for pass or fail. Now, in a gating type environment, it's often very people intensive, and the understanding of what constitutes pass or fail can differ from person to person. And because you do need gatekeepers, it tends to be a very person intensive process. So work stops, you need a gatekeeper to determine if you're able to proceed or not. This is why for cloud, what we've done is moved to a guardrails style of governance. So certain limits are put in place. These are no-go areas. And as long as they're respected, the flow of work can continue uninterrupted. So there's no one sitting there saying go or not go. Because we are using guardrails here as well, that the limits are very, they're not fuzzy, they're very pass-fail, and they can be automated. As well, telemetry can be collected around what constitutes pass or fail, and who is respecting those guardrails. So returning back to the guardrail process itself around cloud, now you'll see this, we use this term quite a bit, enterprise visibility, departmental agility. And so hopefully this will explain that a bit. So from an enterprise point of view, the Government of Canada Enterprise Architecture Review Board governs the guardrails. They decide on what those guardrails are. They look at, should they be added, should they be changed, etc. over time. SSC, because they are the cloud broker, they have visibility into every department's tenant. So every account that they provide, they have visibility into that environment. And so they're able to determine if departments are remaining compliant to those guardrails. When departments are not compliant, this is when Treasury Board comes involved, and escalation of non-compliance issues are brought forward. Again, the Government of Canada Enterprise Architecture Review Board plays an important role in that as well, because they will hold departments accountable for meeting those guardrails. And it's a cyclical type process. So this is the enterprise ring, if you think about it, right? So this is those enterprise actors being able to see that departments are respecting those rules. At the center of that, departments are able to use the cloud to keep provisioning and configuring cloud services and cloud resources uninterrupted. As long as they are respecting the guardrails, they are able to continue their work unimpeded. Again, are on the outer ring, the enterprise has visibility and able to take action if departments are not respecting those guardrails. So what do those guardrails actually look like? Well, there's 12 of them listed here. Those are the 12. Currently, there are 12. And the other thing you'll see is, depending on the type of usage you have for your cloud environment, the guardrails can differ slightly. So the guardrails themselves, I'm not going to go through each one one by one, but you know, they're really focused on access management. They're focused on logging. They're focused on maintaining a perimeter. They're focused on having the marketplace. So the final one you see there is called the marketplace guardrail. And that has to do with contractual limits that we have in place with the framework agreement. But again, it's really focused on access management, perimeter, and logging. So these are minimal protections that we want to see in place for every environment that we have. Again, you'll see, depending upon the usage, for example, if you have a sandbox, some of these guardrails are not required. Now, you might say, but I don't actually have data in my account at this point. I just set it up. Well, you know, these accounts themselves need to be protected, even if there's nothing in it, because there is a threat, right? If someone is able to gain access to these accounts, they could use those accounts to provision resources and use them to attack another environment. And that would be a reputational issue for the Government of Canada. So we want to make sure that these powerful accounts are properly controlled. So now let's talk a little bit about the operationalization framework. So this is the actual process around the guardrails. So you got to love the title, operationalization framework. It's quite a mouthful. But really where it starts with is a department gaining access to the contractual agreement through the cloud broker. Now, depending upon, you may already have a cloud environment through a legacy contractual agreement, the so-called unclassified contract, or you may be requesting a new environment. Either way, you would go through the broker. If you're moving an existing environment into the new contract, you would still work through the broker, or you'd get a new root or global admin accounts, depending on the cloud service you're using. You as a department would be responsible for applying the guardrails as they were stated on the previous slide. SSC verifies compliance and then provides a pass or fail. Now, all of that needs to be done within the first 30 days of gaining access to your account. If you haven't met the guardrails after 30 days, access will be removed to your account and you would basically have to restart the process. For those who do pass, you then go on to actually perform the security assessment and finish the configuration of your environment, start deploying workloads, etc. So what's important to note here, though, is the guardrails are not a substitution for a proper security assessment process. Again, these are just guardrails. They're minimal protections. They're not a replacement for meeting all the security controls within the protected beam medium security control profile. And then finally, again, the outcomes that we're really trying to achieve is enterprise visibility, as well as providing departments with the agility they need in the cloud. So what happens if you become non-compliant to a guardrail? And we call that the escalation process. So SSE produces a monthly compliance report. That report is provided to Treasury Board, and Treasury Board posts that report on GC Collab in the Cloud and Computing Network of Expertise group. So I will be quite clear, we do a bit of naming and shaming there. We want departments to know that those who are not meeting the guardrails need to get back into compliance. As well, that report is provided to the Government of Canada Enterprise Architecture Review Board as an informational item. Again, a little bit of naming and shaming there. We want departments to know that if they are not compliant, they will end up on that list, and there's a discussion that's going to happen. But before that discussion happens, there is a notification. So if you violate a guardrail, that first violation, there is a notification that's sent to the account holder. Often what that notification results in is kind of a, whoops, I didn't know I did, or I didn't notice I had. And typically departments are quite quick to take corrective action and become back into compliance. If, however, there is a second violation, there's a notification to the departmental CIO from the Senior Director of Enterprise Technology within OCIO, within the Office of the Chief Information Officer. Third violation, we're now moving up the escalation chain. It's now a notification to your CIO, but it's coming now from the Government of Canada Chief Technology Officer. And then finally, if departments do persist and there is a fourth violation, and then the Government of Canada Enterprise Architecture Review Board exercises its governance role and decides on an action. So that could be requiring a department takes produces an action plan for making sure this doesn't happen anymore, or it could all the way be all the way up to escalating to an account suspension. So every department is out there becoming compliant to the guardrails, fantastic work, and a lot of them are turning to automation in order to keep that verification up to date. So a number of departments have contributed those tools to put them in GitHub, made them available to others for their usage. So if you are in the process or continuing to remain compliant to the guardrails, I absolutely encourage you to take these tools, and if you want to extend them, contribute back to the community. We only get better as a community by contributing back. So I'd like to always include a bit of myth busting because we tend to sometimes persist in certain myths. So the operationalization framework or the guardrails are a mini SANA process, security assessment and authorization process. So that's a myth. The guardrails are again meant to provide certain minimal protections are in place. They're not a substitute for a full security assessment and authorization process. The second one is, if you're familiar with the GC accelerators, so this basically infrastructure as code that provides you a baseline architecture to help meet a lot of the Government of Canada's security controls. So if you apply those accelerators, you'll meet all the guardrails. Unfortunately, that's not the case. First of all, the accelerators are always evolving, so the day may come when they do meet them all. But some of them are also process-oriented, so at least one of the guardrails is process-oriented and can't be met with a script. So That's false. You have to work to become compliant to the guardrails. There's no magic script. The accelerators, however, reduce the number of guardrails you would have to implement, as they're already built into the accelerators. Another one we often get is, hey, I'm just running a sandbox environment. Do I really need to apply these guardrails? I don't need guardrails in a sandbox or a dev environment. So that's false. As you remember a previous slide, I had shown you that there are a number of different usage profiles, and the number of guardrails you have to meet scale with the usage profile. So I encourage departments to go back to that slide, because we often see this as saying, well, I have a sandbox environment, I don't need the guardrails. Yes, you do. You still need to protect that account. So looking into the future of the guardrails, there's a number of things that we'd like to do. First of all, more automation. It's still a very manual process today, a lot of manual notification. I think we can probably achieve faster verification of compliance through automation, and we can probably also do some real-time notification of compliance for non-compliance, taking a lot of manual steps and getting results back to departments faster, getting them back into compliance faster. More tools to help departments stay compliant. As I said before, the GC accelerators are always improving, so putting new service policies in place, etc., to ensure departments stay within the guardrails. And lastly, you know, you're likely going to see more guardrails in the future. One, we're probably going to move up the stack, and you know, a lot of the guardrails right now are probably a little more IaaS focused, but certainly as we get into certain PaaS services, we may want to establish some guardrails as well. So that's a quick overview of the guardrails. Hopefully you learned a little bit about where they came from, where we're going with them, and why they exist. Again, underlining that why they're really there is it's a way of governing all these departments are out doing fantastic work in the cloud, but providing an enterprise approach to verifying that certain protections are in place and that work is being done safely. So thank you very much, and keep clouding.